for video recording before I leave Australia. And the subject assigned me here tonight is Stay by the Ship, Seven Reasons Why You Should Remain a Seventh-day Adventist. I came here to Australia on this visit specifically because I was invited to present the 1888 message. I've told every audience that I have met that I have no message of my own. I'm not smart enough to think up a message like this. My message is secondhand. I have delivered as best I can the message that Ellen White herself endorsed as being most precious, which she then termed the beginning of the latter rain and a loud cry. But wherever this message is presented, certain problems arise. And I feel that we ought to address ourselves to those problems very frankly, because it's impossible to read the writings of Ellen White as the Lord's messenger without realizing that she says over and over again very clearly that that most precious message was rejected. Now, I do not say that the church rejected that message. Somebody has quoted me as saying that. I do not say that. I never have said that. The simple fact is that it was the leadership that rejected the message, and the church never really had a clear opportunity to consider the message undistorted and unopposed. Ellen White tells us it was the Lord's will that our leading brethren and the lay members pulled together, and then the work could have been finished long ago. We also note with sadness a situation of reality which we might as well face. That is, even today, this most precious message is often resisted, maligned, misrepresented, and even rejected. And so the question keeps coming up, and people keep asking the question, what will the end be? What can we do? There are three options that we can consider. First is what some people are telling us, that because the church, or at least the leadership in history in 1888, rejected the beginning of the latter rain and rejected this most precious message, therefore, they say, the church has become Babylon. Now, if you'll remember the book Testimonies to Ministers, there's a chapter early in the book which is entitled The Remnant Church, Not Babylon. And if I remember correctly, the date for that is 1893. So shortly after the 1888 conference, it became quite apparent to some people that the message had been rejected, and they concluded, therefore, that the church has become Babylon. And Ellen White wrote this testimony to set this matter straight. Even though the message was rejected, this church has not become Babylon. It has not become Babylon even today. And no way is this the solution to our problem, to leave the church and form an offshoot. Never. That is not God's will, and it is not called for. Even throughout the many years of her life, when Ellen White had to contend with opposition and difficulties and backsliding and misunderstandings and even rebellion, time and again, including the terrible Kellogg apostasy in the early part of this century, movement after movement of schism, breaking off, troubles within the church, she never left the church. up to the moment of her death, she remained faithful as a member of the church and labored toward revival and reformation. She finally confessed before her death that the blessed revival she long expected was still future, would have to come after her death. The second option before us is to remain in a lukewarm condition as the church is today. Just be satisfied with that lukewarmness and go on decade after decade like a door that swings on its hinges, and we grow up and we do our work, and then we get old and we retire and we go in the grave, and another generation comes and they grow up and they do their work, and then they retire and they go in the grave, then another generation comes, and the whole process is repeated. It's been going on now for well over 100 years. We can say, well, that's fine, just carry on. As long as we have plenty of food to eat and comfortable homes to live in and plenty of petrol for our motor cars and clothes to wear and so on, just relax and be lukewarm. So what? But the trouble with that option is that this does not bring honor to Christ. This does not resolve the great controversy between Christ and Satan. We are Seventh-day Adventists. And the word Adventist means not one who believes in the Second Coming only, but one who loves the Second Coming, one who wants to hasten the Second Coming. And so the third option before us is to do exactly what our Lord and Savior has advised the angel of the Laodicean church to do. In Revelation chapter 3, he tells us here, because thou art lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, buy of me gold tried in the fire, etc. Then he says, be zealous therefore, and repent. So I'd like to list seven reasons why I believe in the triumph of this denominated church. Seven reasons why you should not ever leave the church. For the first one, I turn to Matthew chapter 16. And here we read a promise that the Lord Jesus made. And like all the promises he made, it will be fulfilled. Verse 18. I say also unto thee, speaking to Peter, thou art Peter, Greek Petros, and upon this rock, Greek Petra, I will build my church, and the gate of hell shall not prevail against it. Now there's a promise that the Lord is going to build his church upon a solid rock. He expects the gates of hell to attack it, but he says they shall not prevail against it. It seems almost as though he is referring to the promise that was made to Jeremiah. In Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 19, the Lord promised him, they shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. For I am with thee, saith the Lord, to deliver thee. And so the enemy will fight against Christ's church, but he will not prevail against the church. But now immediately the question arises, what is the church? I turn to Revelation chapter 12. If I had a copy of Testimonies volume 9, I think I could find a statement there that might be helpful in this connection. But let me turn here to Revelation chapter 12, and here we have the history of the church throughout the ages, the true church, under the symbol of a woman. And after the 1,203 score days or years, we come down to verse 17. The dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now, this obviously is referring to a group of people in the end of time. Thank you for the book. In the end of time, who constitute a remnant. And they are identified as those who keep the commandments of God and have the same doctrines that the apostolic church had in the beginning, when the woman is brought to view in verse 1 and 2. And again in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12, when the three angels proclaim their message throughout the whole world to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, a fruitage is developed in verse 12 of a people who have patience. The word patience means fortitude. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Now, we have always understood that this people are Seventh-day Adventists. Now, I didn't think to look up this statement before I began this presentation, and it may be I shall not be able to find it. But volume 9 of the testimonies contains an explicit statement here somewhere, and maybe I can find it later before we finish this message here, to the effect that Seventh-day Adventists as a denomination constitute the fulfillment of this prophecy in Revelation chapter 12 verse 17 and also chapter 14 and verse 12. In other words, and I say this humbly, Seventh-day Adventists are on the spot. This is our destiny. And when the Lord says in Matthew 16, verse 18, that he will build his church upon this rock of himself, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it, I believe he is referring here to that remnant church as well. Because the remnant church is a part of the church that Christ established. The remnant is the last part of that same church symbolized as a woman. Now, the second reason why I believe this church is going to triumph, and we must stay with it. I'm citing now Revelation 14 and verse 14 and 15, and this refers to the harvest principle. Let me read the verses. I looked and behold a white cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like unto the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and his hand a sharp sickle. Another angel came out of the temple, crying with a loud voice, thrust in thy sickle, reap, for the time has come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. Now this harvest principle states that when God's people develop Christ-likeness of character, then the Lord will put in the sickle, and the second coming of Christ will take place. We find this stated in St. Mark chapter 4, verse 28 and 29. The earth bringeth forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn in the ear. But when the fruit's brought forth, immediately he puts in the sickle, because the harvest is ripe. Now, if we leave the church for any reason whatsoever, we work against this harvest principle. We're all plants, as it were, growing in the Lord's garden. And we must work together to cooperate with heavenly agencies that the harvest may indeed ripen, and thus the coming of the Lord be no longer delayed. That brings me to point number 3. That is that the church is the body of Christ. And this is set forth in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. As members of the body, we either cooperate with the head, which is Christ, or we work against the head. As late a sin in a lukewarm condition, it could be said that as members of the body of Christ, we're sick. We're not yet in that state of perfect health that the head desires. Notice in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 27, you are the body of Christ and members in particular, and God has set some in the church, etc. Then verse 12, as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many in one body, so also is Christ. We bear a corporate relationship to one another and to the head as members of the body of Christ. Verse 13, by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, Jews or Gentiles, and made to drink of one Spirit. Here is corporate unity in the body. And then we find in verses 16 to 19, corporate diversity. Each member of the body is different and has a different responsibility. And then, verse 21, there's corporate need. Each member of the body needs the other. And friends, the head has need of every member of the body. If the body is sick, the head will suffer also. And then verse 23 speaks of a corporate balance of all these various members of the body. Verse 25 says there should be no schism, no division in the body. Then, again, there's corporate concern. Verse 26, whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Now, my point is this. As members of the body of Christ, whether we're the fingernail or the hand or a toe or what we may be, as a part of the body of Christ, if we are sick ourselves, we cannot bring honor and glory to the head. If we're cut off, we cannot bring honor and glory to the head. We must let the blood pour through us and heal us and take away the impurities that we may become healthy and strong in Christ. And that requires growing up into Christ. Ephesians chapter 4 also discusses this matter of the body, the church. And I believe that what we're reading here in the light of Revelation chapter 12 and chapter 14 specifically applies to the Seventh-day Adventist church. Verse 13 of Ephesians 4, till we all come in the unity of the faith, of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Verse 15, speaking the truth in agape, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted, by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, makes increase to the body unto building itself up in agape. Now this is God's plan for the remnant church, for the Seventh-day Adventist church, to build it up in agape. And each of us, as a member of this body, has a distinct responsibility to function in the capacity to which God has called us and fashioned us. Our fourth point. I come now to Revelation chapter 3, the Laodicean message. I wonder if we have thought seriously about the effectiveness of this message. Are these idle words? Is the Lord Jesus wasting his breath on Laodicea? Sometimes I wonder, did Ellen White waste her breath and waste her energies writing all those testimonies through all those years? What good have they done? Well, yes, they have raised up a worldwide church. True, thank the Lord for that. They've been a blessing to countless thousands, even millions of people. No question about that. But still today, the church is not ready for the coming of the Lord. And that was Ellen White's great burden. She did not want to see this remnant church become just another denomination to take its place by the side of the Baptists and the Methodists and the Presbyterians as just another church to go on for thousands of years. That was not her plan. She was a Seventh-day Adventist at heart. She longed to see the Lord come. And we must believe she did not live and labor in vain. Now what about this Laodicean message? Is it going to be effective? Will it accomplish the purpose the Lord intends? That is the question. My conviction is, the answer is yes. The message will accomplish its purpose. I cannot see the Lord Jesus Christ standing there at the door, knocking, 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 forever and ever, and finally walking away, hanging his head in shame and dejection that he's failed. I just cannot accept that. Now, I'm certain that the devil would be happy if that happened. That is Satan's great purpose, to defeat this message right here. And I know that we sometimes get obsessed with this idea of persecution coming and a Sunday law coming and how the devil is working to wreck the economic balance that the world is living on and how he wants to bring wars and so on. And I'm sure he does. But I'm inclined to think that the devil's supreme activity today is to defeat this latest enemy. I think the devil has the keenest brains in his committee working on this project to defeat the latest enemy and to ensure that the church will remain lukewarm forever and never repent. Now, I cannot believe that that's going to happen. I believe that God's love is more effective than that. I believe that what Christ died to accomplish will be done. I believe that when the prophet Daniel was told in Daniel 8, verse 14, unto 2,300 days or years, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. I believe that prophecy will be fulfilled. And therefore, when the Lord Jesus says, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, I believe the angel of this church will do so. And the Lord said, buy white raiment. I believe the counsel will be heeded. When he said, anoint thine eyes with eye salve, I believe his counsel will be heeded. When he says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Repent, therefore, I believe his call will be heeded. I believe his honor, his vindication requires it. Verse 20 contains a direct quotation from the Greek of the Septuagint of the Song of Solomon, chapter 5, and verse 2. And the phrase that is quoted is, I've taken my stand at the door and am knocking, knocking. That is taken from the Song of Solomon. Therefore, this is really a love story. This is the bridegroom appealing to the bride to surrender to him. And if the bride finally says no, the bridegroom must walk away dejected and disappointed. That certainly will not be a successful conclusion of the great controversy between Christ and Satan. We read in Revelation 19, 7 and 8, the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And I believe that is the real significance of the Laodicean message. Point number five. Why this church will overcome and will triumph. Any offshoot that comes out of this church in order to become a valid movement blessed by the Lord to constitute a new remnant church, to prepare a people for the coming of the Lord. Such an offshoot, to be fair, must be given as much time as the Adventist Church has thus far been given. Let me restate that. Maybe that's not very clear. Let me try to say that in simpler words, if I can. There are those who have the idea that the ship is going to sink, or at least be taken to the wrong port. And if you want to get to the heavenly port, you better get in a lifeboat in order to get there, or get on a raft or something. What I'm saying is, to be fair, that new movement, you see, must be given as much time as the Adventist Church has been given to prove itself. Now, what usually happens in history, we're told, and I think this is pretty generally true, that a revival or reformation movement starts off with flying colors, and everything is going fine, and there's a spirit of consecration and repentance and humility and faithfulness, and it seems like the Lord is blessing. And then when this movement, like the Wesleys, for example, you see, the Wesleyan Methodist movement started off with great zeal and earnestness and purity of motive, and the Lord blessed. And then as the decades rolled by, and John Wesley died, and Charles Wesley died, and the church became respected and big, and great big stone churches were built, and statues of John Wesley were put out in front, and so forth, you see, this church became a worldly church. And you take the Lutheran church. Luther was full of zeal, earnestness, you know, and the Lutheran faith was pure in the days of Luther. When Luther died, they soon sort of crept back toward the Catholic Church again, and the Lutheran Church would become a worldly church. And so we find the same thing has happened with the Seventh-day Adventist Church. The bigger we get, the more highly respected we are by the world, the more money we have, the bigger the institutions we have, the wider spread our work, the more thousands of people we baptize, the more lukewarm we get. The more difficult it seems that the problem can be solved. What I'm saying is, if some new offshoot starts a revival and a reformation and apparently enjoys the outpouring of the Spirit of God, to be fair, God should let them have 100 and some years until they grow big and fat and lazy and prosperous, and then see what they will do. And we would expect the very same thing to happen time and time and time again. Therefore, I suggest no offshoot is the solution to the problem. What the Lord says, repentance within the church, that is his answer to the problem. And that brings me now to my next point, point number six. And this one is tremendously important. That is the cleansing of the sanctuary. I'm told repeatedly, and it's been a source of much sadness to me through the 50-some years I've been in Adventist, to watch little groups go off here and there. And usually they say, well, the reason they're leaving the church is that all through history, we read in the Bible, the prophets, the apostles, everybody, failed. Every movement failed. The Lord brought Israel out of Egypt. And as soon as they got to Mount Sinai, they were making a golden calf and worshiping it. And then they came up to Kadesh Barnea, and they rebelled against the Lord, leading had to go back to the wilderness, wander in the wilderness, and they finally got across the Jordan, and they came into the promised land, and then they wanted to make a king for themselves, be like the nations around them. And then the Lord gave them David and Solomon and so on, and then the 10 tribes seceded, and then they began to worship Baal, you know, and then the 10 tribes were taken captive and were scattered all over the world, came to an end, virtually, and then Judah apostatized, and then finally Judah had to go to captivity into Babylon and so on. And so they say, every movement fails the same way. And therefore we can expect, in the last days, the remnant church will fail likewise. At least the organized denomination will fail. And I have an answer to that. And the answer I have is very serious. Something is going to happen after 1844 that has never happened before. Then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Daniel understood that was a clear reference to the heavenly Day of Atonement. I think Daniel knew the year-day principle. Daniel knew Numbers 14:34. He probably knew Ezekiel 4:6 as well. And I think Daniel was wise enough to realize that there is a heavenly sanctuary. David knew it. In fact, all the wise people in Israel, in ancient Israel, understood clearly that all the blood of animals and goats could never wash away one sin. They knew jolly well that it would take the blood of the Lamb of God to wash away their sins. They knew that this earthly temple, this earthly sanctuary, was only a type, because the Lord had said to Moses, make it according to the pattern shown thee in the mount. And Psalm 20 plainly prays, the Lord bless you out of his sanctuary. And the Old Testament talks many places of a heavenly sanctuary. In fact, I was reading not too long ago, I don't remember the reference, but I found a reference in some historical writer who said even the pagan people in Daniel's day had a clear concept of a heavenly sanctuary. And if even the pagans had a concept like that, surely Daniel was wise enough to know that there's a heavenly sanctuary, and that this is a heavenly Day of Atonement that the angel was talking about here. Now in that heavenly Day of Atonement, the wrong must be made right. That is the purpose of the Day of Atonement. And the result is the cleansing of the corporate body of Israel. In the antitype, the cleansing of the corporate body of God's people. Now we can expect the devil is going to use the supreme wisdom of his 6,000 years of experience in fashioning weapons and methods of attack and approach to defeat the work that Christ is doing in the most holy apartment. The great controversy between Christ and Satan has become, since 1844, a controversy between the cleansing of the sanctuary and the anti-cleansing of the sanctuary. That's actually the significance of what's happening today. And what's going to happen depends upon whether Christ gained the victory or not. And we know he will gain the victory. Calvary has ensured that. And so I suggest that the Adventist doctrine of the cleansing of the sanctuary is the answer to this argument that so many people bring up, that because ancient Israel failed, we can expect that modern Israel must also fail. I say no. Something new will happen in history that has never happened before. And now I come to my last point. And this is very significant. And that is, what we need is to study the positive messages in the Old Testament of the ancient prophets. We need to be immersing ourselves in the Bible as never before to learn, to appreciate, to understand the significance of ancient Israel's history. For example, back in the time of Elijah, King Ahab of Israel had married Jezebel, and the two of them together led Israel into Baal worship, and it was terrible. It was an unconscious apostasy. They did not realize they were in apostasy, because the word Baal really means Lord or husband, you see, and they thought they were worshiping Jehovah or Yahweh, the true Lord of Israel, but they had departed from the truth, and Elijah was wise enough to discern the apostasy and to rebuke it. Now, my point is this. Elijah never abandoned Israel. Elijah never renounced his citizenship in Israel to go over and become a citizen of the Philistines, for example, or a citizen of Tyre and Sidon, or Syria, or something like that. He remained an Israelite, even though Israel was in apostasy. But he worked for revival and reformation. And then you come to Jeremiah. Open your Bible, if you will, and let's just take a bird's eye view of this precious prophecy. As I read a few moments ago in chapter 1, verse 19, the Lord told him, "They shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. I'm with thee to deliver thee," said the Lord. The Lord is referring to the leaders of ancient Judah who continually opposed the prophet Jeremiah. Chapter 2 is devoted to setting forth the extent of the apostasy in Judah. Verse 8, "The priests said not, where's the Lord? They that handle the law knew me not. The pastors also transgressed against me, and the prophets prophesied by Baal." And then in chapter 3, the Lord told the people through Jeremiah, verse 3, that the showers of the latter rain have been withheld because of this terrible apostasy of Baal worship. And then in chapter 4, we find the first mention of the coming sword in verse 10. "Then said I, Ah, Lord God, surely thou hast greatly deceived this people and Jerusalem, saying, You shall have peace, whereas the sword reaches unto the soul." It goes on here in verse 19, says, "I have heard the sound of the trumpet, the alarm of war, destruction upon destruction is cried." And thus he predicts the coming destruction when Babylon shall conquer Judah and destroy Jerusalem. Chapter 5, verse 1, says, "Run to and fro through the streets of the city of Jerusalem. If you can find one man who's honest, I'll pardon the city," the Lord said. That was terrible. Couldn't find one man who was honest. Verse 31, "The prophets prophesy falsely. The priests bear rule by their means. It's sad to say, my people love to have it so." And then they come along here taking a bird's eye view. Chapter 6 and 7, the Lord is appealing to the people for them to repent. Come to chapter 8, he says in verse 4, 5, and 6, that don't men get up when they fall? Do not they retrace their steps after a wrong turning? And why does this people persist when they've taken a wrong turning? They stick to their falsehood. They will not retrace their steps. That's a modern translation. And then in verse 21, notice that Jeremiah has an agape motive for his concern. "For the hurt," verse 21, "for the hurt of the daughter of my people am I hurt. I'm black," or "I'm mourning. Astonishment has taken hold on me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered? Oh, that my head were waters, and mine eyes a fountain of tears, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. Jeremiah loved those people. Jeremiah took their suffering upon himself. You don't find Jeremiah in a selfish manner when Nebuchadnezzar came and captured the city. Well, I told you so. You're getting what you deserve. He didn't feel that way. He suffered with the people. And we'll find later here that he also was concerned for the honor of God's name. These are agape motives. And friends, as we pray for revival and reformation in the church, we must remember a self-centered motive will not be effective for revival and reformation. Only an agape motive. In chapter 9, the Lord warned him. Well, he warned the people in the name of the Lord. Trust not in any brother, for every brother will utterly supplant, and every neighbor will walk the slanders. They'll deceive everyone his neighbor, will not speak the truth. They've taught their tongue to speak lies, etc. Now, I'm reading this for a purpose, because my bottom line is coming later in a few moments. We hurry along here. We come to chapter 10. And Jeremiah confesses in verse 23, O Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It's not in man that walks to direct his steps. O Lord, correct me, but with judgment. So Jeremiah is praying that the Lord will straighten him out, even before he's praying the Lord straighten them out. Then chapter 11, verse 9, the Lord said unto me, a conspiracy is found among the men of Judah and Jerusalem. They're turned back to the iniquities of their forefathers. And they're worshiping Baal, verse 13. The Lord has pronounced evil against thee. And then in verse 18, the Lord hath given me knowledge of their apostasy, and I know it. But I was like a lamb or an ox that's brought to the slaughter. I knew not that they devised devices against me, saying, let's cut him off from the land of the living. But, O Lord, the triumph reigns in the hearts. Unto thee have I revealed my cause. You find Jeremiah weeping his heart out, going to the Lord and praying these prayers of desperation. It is always honest. And he cries out in chapter 12, verses 1 and onward, righteous art thou, O Lord, when I plead with thee. Yet let me talk with thee of thy judgments. Why does the wicked prosper? Why are all they happy that deal very treacherously? Thou hast planted them. They've taken root. They grow. They bring forth fruit. Thou art near in their mouth and far from their heart. But Lord, thou knowest me, and thou hast seen me. And the Lord answered him in verse 5. If thou hast run with the footmen, and they've wearied thee, then how canst thou contend with horses? And if in the land of peace, wherein thou trustedst, they wearied thee, then how wilt thou do in the swelling of Jordan? If the Lord says in verse 10, many pastors have destroyed my vineyard. They've trodden my portion underfoot, and made my pleasant portion a desolate wilderness. It mourneth unto me, etc. The situation was terrible. And then we come here to chapter 14. And Jeremiah asks, O Lord, why don't you help us? Why are you like a man astonished, as a mighty man that cannot save? Yet thou, Lord, art in the midst of us. Chapter 15, the Lord said, even though Moses and Samuel stood before me, yet my mind could not be toward this people. There is no hope. They'll be carried away captive to Babylon. And then in chapter 15, verse 17, Jeremiah says, I sat not in the assembly of the mockers, nor rejoiced. I sat alone because of thy hand. Thou hast filled me with indignation. Why is my pain perpetual, my wound incurable? And then the Lord answered him. The Lord answers every honest prayer. And the Lord said, if thou return, if you repent, and don't get discouraged, Jeremiah, then will I bring thee again, and thou shalt stand before me. And if thou take forth the precious from the vial, thou shalt be as my mouth, and I will make thee unto this people a fenced, brazen wall. They shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. For I am with thee to save thee and deliver thee, saith the Lord. Jeremiah was tempted to discouragement. The Lord said, hang on. Now let's see how that was fulfilled. Moving along here, as fast as we can, we come to Jeremiah chapter 20. We find that Pashur, the son of Immer the priest, who was also chief governor in the house of the Lord, heard that Jeremiah prophesied these things. Verse 2, then Pashur smote Jeremiah the prophet and put him in the stocks and tried to humiliate him. Would have killed him, but he couldn't do that. The Lord protected Jeremiah. But it hurt Jeremiah, because he cries out in verse 7, O Lord, thou hast deceived me. What a prayer for a man to pray. To tell the Lord, you've told me a lie, Lord. What a prayer. I was deceived. Thou art stronger than I and hast prevailed. I'm in derision daily. Everyone mocketh me. Then I said, verse 9, I'm going to shut up. I'll not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. I'm going to keep still from here on out, never say another word. But, he says, his word was in my heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones. And I was weary with forbearing, I could not stay. And so he kept on giving his testimony, and the Lord kept on blessing him. Chapter 23, the whole chapter devoted to the pastors. Woe be to the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, saith the Lord. He will set up shepherds over them which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, nor shall they be lacking, saith the Lord. And then comes the promise of the coming of Christ. In verse 18, who has stood in the counsel of the Lord, and hath perceived and heard his word? Who hath marked his word and heard it? Verse 15, the last part of the verse. From the prophets of Jerusalem is profaneness gone forth into the whole land. Verse 21, I have not sent these prophets, yet they ran. I have not spoken to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel and had caused my people to hear my words, then they should have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their doings. The Lord hears what false prophets say, and the Lord is the judge. This whole chapter is a tremendous chapter to study. We come over here now to chapter 26. And here we have an interesting story of how the Lord defended Jeremiah in his hour of greatest need. The Lord said, stand in the court, the Lord's house, verse 2, and speak to all the cities of Judah. All the words I command thee, diminish not a word. So verse 7, the priests and the prophets and all the people heard Jeremiah speaking these words in the house of the Lord. And when he made an end of making his speech, that verse 8, the priests and the prophets and all the people, notice that, took him saying, thou shalt surely die. Why have you prophesied in the name of the Lord, saying, this house shall be like Shiloh, and this city desolate without an inhabitant? And all the people were gathered against Jeremiah in the house of the Lord. Looked bad, didn't it? The priests were against him, the prophets were against him, and all the people. There was one group that hadn't come in yet. Verse 10. When the princes of Judah heard these things, they came up from the king's house. And the priests and the prophets said to the princes, this man is worthy to die. Verse 11. He's prophesied against this city. You've heard it with your own ears. Now, notice what Jeremiah did. He did not run away, but he spoke up. Then said Jeremiah, the Lord sent me to prophesy against this house and against this city. Therefore now amend your ways and doings. Obey the voice of the Lord. As for me, verse 14, and in your hand, do with me as seemeth good and meet with you. But know for certain, if you put me to death, you shall surely bring innocent blood upon yourselves. Of a truth, the Lord has sent me to speak all these words. Now notice what happened in verse 16. Then said the princes and all the people unto the priests and the prophets, this man is not worthy to die. He has spoken unto us in the name of the Lord our God. Now that is a fulfillment of the Lord's promise. They shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Now, some of the elders got up, and they said to the people that there was another man whose name was Micah the Morishite, said the same thing as Jeremiah in the days of Hezekiah. Did Hezekiah put him to death? No. Hezekiah listened to him. And then there was also a man, verse 20, whose name was Urijah, the son of Shemaiah, of Kirjath-Jearim, who said the same thing that Jeremiah said. And when Jehoiakim the king heard of it, he sought to put him to death. And Urijah was scared, was afraid, fled, and went into Egypt. And Jehoiakim the king sent to Egypt, got him out, and they killed him with a sword, and threw his body into the grave of the common people. The point is, Jeremiah was not afraid. Standing up boldly, courageously, telling the truth, the Lord upheld him. But this man Urijah, because he was afraid and ran away, the Lord could not protect him. It's a sin to be afraid. That's the point of this story. Now, the bottom line, why am I taking you through Jeremiah like this? Would you please turn over to Jeremiah chapter 32. The setting here is the 10th year of Zedekiah, king of Judah. Zedekiah was the last king of Judah. He reigned only 11 years before the city was destroyed and he was taken captive, or slain with the sword. So this was 1 year before the end. The apostasy is deep and terrible. And what happened? We read here in chapter 32 that Jeremiah demonstrated his faith in the future of Judah by buying a parcel of land in Anathoth. And the Lord said to him, although I will give this city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and although these people have done evil and provoked me to anger, verse 32, their kings, their princes, their priests, and their prophets, and so forth. Yet, he says in verse 37, I will gather them out of all countries whither I've driven them in mine anger, my fury, and in great wrath, and bring them again to this place. They shall be my people. I'll be their God. I'll give them one heart, one way, that they may fear me forever. I'll make an everlasting covenant with them. I'll not turn away from them. I'll put my fear into their hearts. They shall not depart from me. 42, Like as I brought all this great evil upon them, so will I bring upon them all the good that I promised them. And fields shall be bought in this land, whereof you say, it's desolate, without man or beast, is given into the hand of the Chaldeans. Men shall buy fields for money, and seal them, take witnesses, for I will cause their captivity to return, saith the Lord. Now, I think that is a beautiful example of the confidence of a true prophet in the ultimate triumph of God's work and the ultimate victory of the church. Every true prophet proclaims good news. Every false prophet either tells lies or proclaims bad news. And it's interesting that all the prophets of ancient Israel, in times of apostasy and backsliding, they always had good news for the people. And so I'm suggesting in closing tonight that what we need desperately is good news, the gospel. Rather than majoring in exposing error, let us concentrate our efforts in proclaiming truth. Let us concentrate our efforts in proclaiming the everlasting gospel of Christ. And I'm thankful for the invitation that brought me to Australia for this visit to proclaim the essentials of the 1888 message. That most precious message will bring healing and confidence. The heart of that message is agape. I read that the other night in the meeting we had in one of these churches nearby here, from Testimonies to Ministers, where Ellen White quotes the agape passage in 1 John 4, and then she says, this is the work the Lord designed the 1888 message to accomplish. The church is built up in agape. And my prayer, as I leave Australia, my prayer is that every human soul who has heard my voice, who has heard this message of agape, this most precious message, that everyone will himself become a missionary to proclaim that gospel. That gospel that will do its work in the hearts of people and bring healing, to heal the alienation and bring God's people together in unity. And friends, I'm convinced that's exactly what we need. We're starved for the pure truth of the everlasting gospel. As long as we feel rich and increased with goods and need of nothing, we cannot appropriate that gospel. Only if we have a hunger and a thirst will we feel the need for the gospel. And I am so thankful to be alive today. I'm thankful for the health reform message. I might be in my grave if it wasn't for that. And my choice is, as long as the Lord gives me breath, I want to proclaim good news to every human heart I meet. Why? Well, to accomplish this work that we see set forth in Isaiah chapter 61. Beautiful passage. You can take it to yourself, if you will, by faith. Verse 1, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. The Lord hath anointed me to proclaim good tidings. That's the gospel, isn't it? Unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captive, the opening of the prison to them that are bound. And then verse 2, to proclaim 364 days of the Lord's acceptance to one day of his anger and his vengeance. That's what the Hebrew implies. The acceptable year of the Lord and the day of the vengeance of our God. that the Lord's mercy is 364 to 1. You see? That's what we must proclaim. To comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that the Lord will be glorified. May each one of you become that minister of righteousness. Wherever the Lord has placed you, that's my prayer for you folks in Australia. Shall we pray? Father, we close this presentation with an appeal for forgiveness, for heart cleansing, for love for our brethren and sisters, even the love of Christ, to motivate us. Give each one of us the joy of lifting those heavy burdens, the joy of seeing some discouraged, bewildered soul take hope and courage because of the gospel of Christ that we've proclaimed. So, Father, encourage us with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Make us each one to be missionaries for thee, that we may help to hasten the coming of our Lord and finish his work to his honor and glory. We pray in Jesus' name.